Congressman Kennedy and I always say on this show that if we only had about 20 more Barney Franks, we could actually launch progressive agendas in this country. I want to begin by telling you we're all
appreciative.
That's
very gracious. Thank you.
We really do appreciate that. The health care debacle, you have your very well-defined ideas about where we ought to go with it. What is the 10,000 foot of where you want to, what you want to accomplish in this session?
Well, I think the best we can do now is a real public option. It is interesting that the, you know, it's very clear. The main objection the Republicans and a few conservative Democrats have to a public option is precisely that people will like it too much, that they really don't want to give people a chance to show that they would prefer it. I think some good work's being done. Senator Schumer and Senator Rockefeller and some people here, Speaker Pelosi, has been very staunch. And I think it is achievable that we get some form of a public option. And I think the conservatives are right about this. I think it is going to be attractive to people. You know, we live in this kind of parallel universe down here where it's the private insurance companies who are our saviors, and they have to stop us from the mean government. I mean, that is just so backwards from even a couple years ago that it's stunning.
You know what scares the hell out of everybody? I mean, really, the basic facts that we got about $2 million a day moving through Washington. We hear the Baucus stories, you know, whether there's entirely accurate. I just don't know how a man takes millions of dollars from an industry and says, I'm now going to take control over that industry. Now, look, it's politics. People always, there's money that moves through with everybody. But how do you separate yourself from the onslaught of 1,400 lobbyists up there, from $2 million a day moving through there? How does somebody keep their eye on the ball?
Well, I have to say, I disagree very much with Max Baucus here. I do think he's motivated more by what he sees as the vote count. But I think your job when you're in the leadership position is not just to count the votes, but try to move them.
Right.
And structure things so you do that. I do say, though, that I wish it were just the lobbying. Here is this problem. It's the conservatives reaping the benefit of their own mistakes. They ruined government. They trashed government. Mm-hmm. They had a government that didn't do any of the regulation that should have been done and helped bring about the financial crisis. They didn't do anything after Katrina. Here's the dilemma. After 8 years of right-wing rule, the whole notion of government has been denigrated. Now, when we want to use our capacity to come together and cooperate, which is what we call government, it's unpopular. So part of what we have here is an unpopularity among voters who are, I think, in some cases in the short term, not recognizing their own interests. And the answer is the right-wingers say, oh, you want the government to get involved. Look what a terrible job the government did. Well, the government did a terrible job because they were in charge of it, and they don't believe in government. And when you put someone in charge of something that he or she doesn't believe in, not surprisingly, you get a bad result. So it's partly the lobbyists, but it's partly we have to explain to people that, no, incompetence is not necessary in government. That's just what happens when you put people who are ideologically opposed to any constructive action in charge.
Well, when did you decide in your career, I mean, this may be an overstatement, but I mean, from the outside looking in, people, they root for you. When you go in, you have this understanding that there's really niceties are great, but absurd niceties do harm to your ability to be an effective congressman. I loved it. We've played it on the show. I've talked about it on Fox News. They have me on as their token liberal from time to time. And I talk about when you confronted this person that was at the town hall meeting, and you said, you know, you said what we were all thinking as we listened to that. What planet do you come from? You know, vile, contemptible nonsense coming from your mouth. We all wanted to say that. And then all of a sudden, Barney Frank says it. It's like Grayson right now. He's saying what's in our heart. And what I've wondered is, when did that light go off with you? And you said, you know, politics, you have to, you know, there's niceties, there's place for niceties, but by God, you don't show up at a knife, you know, at a gunfight with a knife. When did that go off for you?
It's probably, you know, being a kind of a double minority. Look, I, you know, realized... I knew I was Jewish from the time I was conscious, and I realized when I was 13 that I was gay. And living, you know, I'm growing up in the 50s and into the 60s, and I'm gay and I'm Jewish. And I guess from the beginning, it became clear to me that I wasn't going to be any I wasn't going to get 100% of the support.
Yeah.
That there were prejudices. You know, some of them have decreased. Anti-Semitism has largely disappeared. Anti-gay feeling has diminished. But earlier in my life, I lived with that. And I think that's the advantage. I've got some friends who are kind of very mainstream, and some of them thought they could get everybody to love them. Well, yeah. When you start out knowing that there's some people who are not going to be your friends, you're freer. There's a great line, and I guess I may have learned this from Felix Frankfurter, Supreme Court Justice Frankfurter, in an oral biography that he gave before he became on the court. He talked about when he was arguing before the Supreme Court in the 19-teens and 20s, and there was an anti-Semitic justice appointed by Woodrow Wilson, a guy named McReynolds, mm-hmm. and he was anti-Semitic explicitly back 100 years ago. And whenever Felix Frankfurter began to argue, he would very ostentatiously pick up something and read it, making it clear that he wasn't paying attention to Frankfurter. And Frankfurter said he was doing me a favor because he reminded me I had no chance to win him over.
Yeah.
And if he was standing there and smiling at me, I might have been diverted. And that's what I do. You realize there are some people you're never going to win over.
Yeah.
Stop. Don't let them throw you off course. Focus on the people you can reach.
You know how I've heard it characterized? Is it Barney Frank deals with rejection better than any politician out there? And there is an element. It's almost like telling a young trial lawyer, you can't be fearful of rejection because people are going to reject sometimes what you're about.
Absolutely right.
And so somewhere along the line, you have made that a fabric. And I almost want to say, you know, I'm almost thinking, hopefully Alan Grayson is taking the lead here. He's fairly, new.
By the way, you know, people venerate him, and Franklin Roosevelt gave a speech in which he said, you know, these people hate me and I welcome their hatred. And he didn't say that because he was masochistic, but because he knew what it was based on. So I appreciate that. And I do think that's, but I will say this. I think when I did that, a number of my colleagues saw that I was getting a very good reaction and were encouraged to do the same thing.
Well, let me just tell you something. The money flowed probably to you because people want to believe that they've got a fighter on their side. I know it's flowing to Grayson down here. I've sent him a check myself. Yep. Because I think that the progressive movement, really, Congressman, I can't overstate this. You can't believe the hunger that's out there by progressives to say, by God, get mad, jump in the middle of it. You're dealing with thugs. You're dealing with Glenn Beck thugs, Rush Limbaugh thugs, Politico thugs. You're dealing with thugs, and you don't treat them nicely. And I think to be on this side of the microphone and listening to every day I hear it, every day I hear, when are they going to get mad? It is refreshing, and hopefully
well, you'll
approach
it.
You'll approach this health care issue with the same kind of
I agree. Look, let me just say, in that meeting I had, it was actually called by the Berger Group people, the Democratic Town Committee, the town of Dartmouth, Mass. There were a number of very civil conversations. So I think you treat people the way they treat you.
Yeah.
That's what I did. So listen, it's nice for you to say that because it does
well,
put me up and keeps me going.
What do you think? What do you think the way to handle Blue Dog Democrats? I mean, when we deal with the Blue Dog Democrat question, here's what comes to my mind. I have we have people email us, call us, write us letters, say, look, the Blue Dog Democrats, the very vocal Blue Dog Democrats, they represent less than 5% of the entire American population, and we're bending too much to their wants and their needs.
Well, let me say this, because these are people, on the whole, who I think want to be on our side. These are not the very right-wing Republicans. Part of the problem is, look, in fairness, a lot of these people come from districts that John McCain carried big.
Mm-hmm.
And, there are a couple that I think may revel in trying to throw sand in our eyes, but most of them are trying hard. And I guess I can just say this. My major work in financial services are trying to get the kind of regulations we need to prevent the abuses. These are people who are representing constituencies that are, on the whole, more conservative, and it's legitimate to press them and to try and work with them. But overwhelmingly, I don't think these are people who are trying to be problematic. And in many cases, I find that.
How do you interact with them? What is it that you do to try to lead with them?
I've always been curious about problems are and try to figure out if there are ways that we can achieve our goal that meets some of their political needs.
You have to wonder, though, whether or not we use the stick enough within our own party. I mean, look, I've heard you critical of the Republicans. I've been hugely critical of the Republicans of being lockstep without an original thought. And that is the other side of the blue dog Democrat issue, isn't it? I mean, there
it is. And look, part of the problem was this. The right-wing Republican leadership was successful in making Republicans from New York State and Connecticut and New Hampshire and elsewhere in the Northeast vote down the line like a right-winger, and so they all lost. And we don't want to do the same thing on our side.
Congressman, thank you for joining us, okay? It's always a pleasure.
I appreciate it.
Bye-bye.